Welcome to the Mathetai podcast. My name is Mike, and I'm very excited today to share an episode with you. We recorded just a bit ago with our friend in life and our friend in ministry, Costi Keenan. Costi grew up in Bucharest, Romania, under the communist government. He's got a very unique story, and God has turned his story around and employed him in a way that is very unique, for which Costi is uniquely qualified. So I'm excited for you to hear his story, hear what God is doing with him, and just hopefully be challenged yourself in how you can be a part of things and what God would want to do with your story, how he can use you and employ you in his kingdom business. Now, as we get into this episode, I want to give you fair warning that it was recorded over the internet, and so the audio may not be 100% spot on. There were some times where the internet cut out on his end. The Romanian internet was not as reliable. It was overloaded a few times. We got cut off a few times, but we've melded it together as best as possible. Forgive any of the audio insyncrasies, some of the audio issues that we have had. And I think his story is worth telling, even though it's not the perfect audio that we'd hope for. So in the future, when we have the chance, we'll re-record it sitting down face to face and get to talk there. But this is the first in our series we're calling From the Deck, a series of interviews with people in missions, in ministry, and simply in Christian life to hear what they're doing, what God has done, and hopefully to inspire and motivate each of us in our walks, in our lives, and in our ministries to push forward and do the work of the Lord and in the various places that we find ourselves. So I hope that you're blessed today with this interview with Costi Keenan from Bucharest, Romania. All right, well, we're here with Costi Keenan. He's coming to us live from Bucharest, Romania. So Costi, welcome and thank you for being here on the Mathetai podcast.
It's good to be here. Thank you for having me, Mike. It's an honor to get to share a little bit with you guys today.
Yeah, now you and I met in a unique way. You came from Romania to America and finally to Mississippi. And then we moved as a family to Mississippi shortly after Hurricane Katrina. And we got to spend, about 6 months there in Mississippi together?
9 months, but yeah.
9 months. Okay. Well, maybe it felt shorter than it really was. And then from there, we've each gone our separate directions. You went to Florida and then back here to California. And then now you're back over in Romania. And, you know, I know God's called you to a very specific and unique ministry that you are uniquely equipped for. And so that's kind of where we want to spend our time today, talking about your story and the ministry God's called you to. So let's start with that. Tell us a little bit about your background in Romania, first of all. Start at the beginning and give us a little bit of a foundation for where you've come from.
Yeah, it's always a little harder to think back when I was a kid. Because I don't really remember much of my childhood. Mm-hmm. I only have like bits of either traumatic or emotional or like things that were happening in my life. And so the one thing that I remember as far as my childhood, but just a little bit of the background, I grew up in the government state-run orphanages, even from birth, from the point of coming into this earth and being in a hospital, and then from there transition to the different orphanages.
So you went directly from the hospital being born directly into the orphanage system. You never went home with your birth parents or anything like that?
Yeah, so we've never had along with me were other kids. We never had that, you know, that that time where your mom would hold you and, you know, spend a few days in the hospital and take you away. You know, we end up staying there. And this is things that I've been told. So I don't even remember as far as, you know, being 1 year old, 2 year old, you know. So, sure. But what they told us is, we, yeah, so, actually,
being 3 years old and being in an being at the orphanage, and people came visiting that one time, and I think it was people were telling me this, but I remember the face of the people, and I remember them saying they're my, and then there were two older people, so I would think they're my were my grandparents, and I remember people telling me that she's my sister. When I say people, probably the people that were watching over us at that time, you know, just who these people are. And I remember they brought a bunch of orphanage, and they brought food for everybody there. It was kind of a special day for me because they gave me so much attention, you know, and it made me smile and it made me be happy. And so, and this was definitely a communist or facility, because everywhere you go in that facility, there was a picture of Ceausescu, you know, the president at the time, you know. Mm-hmm. And his delegate, and you know he's fat. And I remember around that time, and it was the time where he was assassinated, and I remember when people heard that he died, that all those pictures just kind of went with it, and people were like stomping their feet and, you know, on them, and like it was almost the end of the communist time, you know. I was a very young kid, you know, growing up into this, you know, at the end of the communist time, you know.
If that was your family, this would have been the only time that you actually met your potential birth parents and any extended family. That would have been the only time you've ever actually seen or met them in any way.
Yeah, so that was the first time and the only time. And then as years went by, I was waiting for them to come back somehow. And one thing that they don't do at these orphanages, orphanages connect you, the child, with the families that they know you have. And so they don't set up meetings with them. They don't try to have you make phone calls and things like that. They're shown once or ever. And so,
there's no attempt really to place you back with your birth family. That you're in the institution and that's it.
Yeah. So, you know, even today, kids in the orphanage are still, you know, that someone can claim them and that someone can come for them. And the more I was in it, the more I longed for that family, for that someone to come claim me, for that someone to come take me, you know, and so. But I was in this one orphanage in Bufta, which is outside of Bucharest. And then with that, because I was at an age, they transitioned to another orphanage, but it was in Bucharest where we are now. I end up at the age of nine, to this boys orphanage. 200 boys, I want to say, here, and it was a huge facility.
Yeah, that's the facility that you and I went to when I was there a while back. And it's a just so everybody knows what we're talking about. It's a large concrete building, what, three stories tall?
Four
stories tall. Had a large concrete courtyard with a basketball hoop in it, but it was, you know, small windows,
not a whole lot of life and hope that the building gave us. It's a very sterile building.
Yeah, right now it's been abandoned. So, but I own it, and it's been abandoned the same way kids have been abandoned. Like nobody cares for it.
Yeah.
Just that thought of even a building, you know, people, you know, let alone for a child, for a breathing person.
Yeah.
But I was there for quite a few years, and I don't want to say it was for me there, because there were some really good times. That was life for us, you know, and I came to accept the fact that that's my life, you know. And so, but I was also an emotional, because, you know, yes, you live there and no family relationship other than the boys and the domnas and the domnos there, but then no family, nothing. But then there are quite a number of kids that were leaving there in the weekends. They were going home.
Oh, okay.
And so, which didn't make sense to me, you know, why is that group of people get to go home and not, we're in the same boat, I would think, you know, and the same age, you know. So I had a really hard time. That was the hardest, seeing my friends, seeing the people that I love, that I am growing up with, leaving Ken. Mm. You know, and then there's only a few of us that are staying back, you know.
All of these kids knew family that would come and take them for the weekend or something. The families were just unable to support them, or didn't want to regularly support them perhaps, but they had families, but just were not a part of them on a regular basis.
Yeah. So all these kids had those families that would come and pick them up in the weekends. Mm-hmm. And one of the reasons, you know, even today kids end up in the orphanage is because they can't provide for them.
Right.
So the government came up with a program for them, because some of them, and so the government had to do something about it. So they set up these state-run orphanage kids. And I don't know how the system, this going home in the weekend started, and just that back and forth, I have no idea. They wanted to have a place for these kids to live in. So I'm thinking, these families, chance for kid, for the government to take care of and give them the opportunity to come take them in the weekends. Mm-hmm. That if these families want to take them home eventually, then they have the right to do so.
Okay.
But
a social support system for families that couldn't take care of their kids.
Right. So this system.
The government didn't provide them with funds in their
own.
They took them out of their homes and put them in these orphanages. Okay.
The system was being built up as it went. Mm-hmm. The child trying to. Eventually, that was the idea, is to take these kids and put them back into their homes. And so the adoption back then, it wasn't as popular back then. But I was one of those kids that ended up staying back. I had nobody, no family, and you know, just to come visit, because sometimes a relative would come, like an uncle or a grandma or a grandpa would come and visit the child. Mm-hmm. Not necessarily the parents themselves, you know. So it was like the relatives and come in and visit, or even take me. And so that was like for me, is staying outside in the courtyard and watching from the corner, or watching from the kids leaving, going. And it was tough. And but with that, I started getting busier on the orphanage to kind of help me forget some of the things that I was going through. I made a life there, you know. I had things that I needed. I had a bed, I had a pillow and things. But I knew the most important I really wanted is someone to like claim me, someone to like recognize me of who I am, someone to even ask me my name or, you know, how are you feeling? You know, how are you? You know, it's just drawn to people recognizing me for who I am. And so,
love and the acceptance that a family would normally provide. Here you've got a family of 200 plus boys, if you will, and then a few adults that are overseeing this whole thing, but it's not the family relationships in the same way. All of these guys are off doing their own thing, and they're your brothers in the sense, but you don't have that, you know, you wanted that deeper family connection for the identity side of it.
But it was hard in the weekends, but it was better in the week. But it wasn't always like this. Being in the orphanage, we did have visitors, and we did have people come in and, you know, recognize of, you know, making special things for us, doing Christmas and doing, you know, taking us places, doing this. So we weren't all alone. You know, we had people visiting us, but we just never had, until I go into the story of my parents, we never had people time with us, quality time with us, you know. Even to, you know, in the ministry that we do, we see people come in, Romanians, orphanages, and drops off a bunch of stuff, and then they just leave.
Yeah.
You know, so kids are being raised with the idea of people doing something nice for them because I guess they deserve it or they're obligated to help them because of the situation they're in, and expect people to leave. You know, they don't have this idea of, hey, they're just going to drop stuff off and then they're taking off. You know, so we had to make things actually a little harder on someone that's actually wanting a relationship.
Sure, yeah.
You know,
yeah, for and these form relationships, it's probably really tough. They're used to, like you said, people just coming, spending a day, providing a physical need, and then leaving, and you never have any depth of relationship. So
yeah,
now to build a meaningful, lasting relationship with one of these children, it's a barrier that you have to cross first of all.
Yeah, and it's what I even now thinking, looking back, mm-hmm. you know, it's what I long for, is needed. It's that, you know, first of all, accept this, and just that them wanting to build that relationship with me, you know.
Yeah.
And but you know, there comes story of my parents.
Always at the end, huh?
You know, and being still in the orphanage, you get this group of people coming, and I used to call them strangers, foreigners. Mm. Today, back then I called them strangers because they were strangers with us, and they also spoke a different language.
Yeah.
So, you know, so to me, I can't even understand them. They can't understand me, and I don't know who they are, you know.
Sure.
The huge group of them came this one summer, you know, in this orphanage, in this building that we mentioned earlier. And before, they were going to take a group of kids to camp. Now, this is one of the first many camps that I went on. I've never gone to a camp like that before. The government does provide camps for these kids or us, but nothing like the camp they put together. And so, but just that quick, that day of their arrival there, it was just a hook for me.
Yeah.
Because you get picked in the courtyard among all these people into see who they are and asking them questions and like, what did they bring us? You know, stuff, you know, but they came with nothing. You know, they just.
All right. So you had folks. Yes, you were looking for what they could give you.
Yeah. So we had a bunch of, we were all in the yard when this group of people came. And so, like I mentioned earlier, we call them all strangers. Straini, 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 here. Sunt aici. They're here. And so we are all very excited. And so, and then we had the courage to go out with them. We had kids that just like, you know, little by little used to. And then you have someone like me that just like in the back. Trying to figure out who they are and you know, get to talk to them or not. But I remember this group of people coming in, and I remember my parents being part of that group. And it was my dad, my mom, Bob, and Teresa, and then the three kids at the time. And I remember Josiah, my dad was carrying Josiah in that little backpack thing, and it was just like a chair thing. And they were there, and they were just the nice. They were like smiling, you know. to see people smiling at us, you happen too often. You know, because when you think of the people that were watching us, people were living during that communist time and doing that, you know, it's like upset about something. They're always mean about something, or they're always like yelling at us, you know, like they're blaming us for their attitude, right. You know, and then seeing this group of people smile at us, you know, it was a strange, it wasn't common, you know.
your adoptive family, not your birth family, so this is a new group of people that is coming in. The folks that you're calling your parents now and your brothers and sisters are your adoptive family. Yes. Not your birth family. Yeah, just clarify that.
Yes. Yeah.
Which is
why I have you to clarify my.
I'll translate your Romanian as well in a little bit.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
Yeah. And that's a rare circumstance there, because not a lot of the kids were being adopted out of the orphanages. So it was a unique opportunity for you, and a unique thing to happen in your life to be adopted out. It's not something that was normal.
Yeah, and that came like probably a year and if I I met them first. But they were there, and that day was just a special day. And then the second day, the same group of people came, but they came with this huge bus. We've never seen that big of a bus before, and it was just like a two-story bus, you know. Wow. Just things were happening that were just like, this is not happening, you know. It's just to us, it's like it blew our mind, the different things we're seeing, because we've been able to meet this. And the bus came and took us to camp. And then that week at camp, again, there's no words to express that I had, and I'm sure other kids had at camp, because it wasn't a normal, you know, it wasn't, you know, the normal camp that we would go to. They would take us in days doing nothing, you know, and because government would rent this place, like cabin place or whatever, and all we do is just play soccer rooms, you know, maybe go throw yourself in the water and the program going. And so to be able to be at this camp and have one thing after another for us was like, we were tired, you know? And you but it was just, it was great. It was great because
you had all of these people pouring into you. What's that? I said, you have all these people pouring into you relationally for the first time, spending time and talking to you and asking questions and being involved in your life rather than just letting you guys run and do activities.
It was, what's that? A total turnaround of what we expected at a camp.
Yeah.
You know, so for these people to actually get to know us, get to know who we are, it just, to me, to other kids, they're like, they gave them all the attention they wanted, and they go, they, you know, they, to me, it was just like, oh my goodness, this is a life changing, you know? Yeah. And speaking about this family that now, out the family, I just could not let go of them. Mm. You know, I just could not, you know, I remember, you know, Teresa's hand, and I wouldn't let go. And I was older than their kids, you know. I remember, you know, hanging out with Josiah and going to the pool and the water around. And I remember him, you know how some people come in and if they don't Lord in their hearts and really that sensitivity about circumstance, you know, they might have some ideas and they have some kind of rejection between and that person, you know. Mm-hmm. But all I'm saying is like these people care about all of that. They just didn't care. They wanted to just love on us. And even the kids that wanted to spend time with us, you know? And that just, me, it was just like, it's overwhelming to even think of the time. They just, it was a life turnaround for me. I looked at that life because of that week. You know, I looked at life differently because of what happened that week. Mm. You know, and I believe is where I found hope, but I have no idea what that is, what those feelings were, what is, you know, I had no idea what God started to do into my life. I know now, but I know that comfort, and that was the grace that God poured into them to give to, you know. Mm. And I wanted to just stay there forever, but they had to bring us back to the orphanage, and just everything just kind of stopped 6 months because people stopped coming. Well, I guess the Christmas came around, you know, the 6 months went by, you know, it was that hard time again, you know. And so the six months later, another good news, life changing for me, or something special for me, I'm 13. For sure whether it was on my birthday or a couple days that Bob and Teresa, my adoptive parents now, came for a visit 6 months later.
So they came and visit us at the orphanage once again, And I mentioned earlier that I can't remember whether it was a few days before my birthday or a couple of days after my birthday, because it was around my birthday week. And that was just that to me, it was just the birthday gift. That was my birthday gift. Actually, we barely knew what a birthday gift is, because it's not normal for someone to recognize our birthday or to get a cake or something. And so, or someone to sing us, it wasn't normal. It wasn't uncommon in the orphanage for us to get a birthday song or anything like that. And so, but to me, it was a gift, because I came to love these people, and I came to, you know, it just brought back the, you know, that week that we had together at camp, you know, and I was so excited to see them. And it was the thing they told us, which was interesting to me, is at that time was like, they had moved from America, they told us, to Bucharest, and we were going to see them more often. Uh-huh. And that was just like, that was, you know, it was the only reason I say interesting, because I didn't understand that concept of people moving or leaving a place to come, you know. And so I later found out the kind of story behind what had happened for them to move to Romania, you know, all those miles and all those things they've done to move to Romania, and what it takes to move a family to Romania.
Right. That, and what brought them to make that move?
Well, for one, it was God, and God just pressed on that on their heart to, that is what God is calling them. And two is, I think it was us. I think it was my dad wanted to invest in us. Although when you ask them, they're gonna tell you, we had no idea what we're gonna do. we had no plans. We had no idea, you know. Mm-hmm. But if you ask me, you know, they came for me. They came for us. They came to invest in us. However that was gonna look like, I always look at it, they came for me specifically. They came to be present in my life, because they understood. You know, they understood that rejection that we kept having, you know, from people, and for, you know, for people loving them. And I saw that in them. They came to be present in our lives, you know. And so, you know, God brought them, and it was them answering that call.
Yeah.
It was them making that decision as a family to come move. And then so they moved, and 6 months later, and they were living in this little apartment. And to just kind of skim through the story, I eventually started going over to their house on weekends. So again, if you look back, if you remember me saying that there were weekends where I did not go. Actually, there were every weekend that I didn't get to go home or didn't get to go to a place. Now, here's me going to a place.
You're leaving on the weekends. Yeah.
Yeah. Now I'm leaving, you know? And so, and that was just like, you know, even one, I remember one weekend is me still being in the orphanage and not going anywhere. And I remember me going up to the director's office and asking him if I can call them to come see us or to come. I can't remember what was the reason, but I wanted to see them, you know, because it was weekend. It was like, they have to be here. you know, and so I called them, and I remember them saying, well, we weren't planning on coming, you know. I think they had something going on that weekend, but they came. They came, you know. I called them and they were there a few hours later, you know, and it was just like, you know,
to be prioritized.
Thank you for putting it out there. It showed
that you were valuable in their eyes and worth giving up whatever they were doing to come and be with you, that when you needed somebody, you had someone there for you now, finally.
That's
huge.
So
wow.
But the more I spent time with them, the more I became part of the family, you know. And one thing that I really respected my dad is my adopted dad is he would come and he would give the same quality of time to the other kids. Mm. You know, he never put out any difference in any of the kids, you know. Now, if you ask the kids back then, you know, the other way around, they thought that they became jealous of me because I got to go to the house more than they ever got to the house, you know. So it was like totally the other way, the opposite. But when you ask my dad, or when you hear the story, you know, is, you know, he would spend time with us. He would do the Bible study with us. I fell in love with the game of basketball because he came over with the basketball ball, and he started playing basketball with us, and I fell in love with the sport, you know. But he would make that time for all of us boys. And then it wasn't just me going to their house. There were other boys, you know, my mom, this little apartment was full of kids, you know, and this huge meal that my mom was making at the time. And it was just, everybody knew of Mama Teresa and Bob, Bob, you know, little seed. It's called in Romanian, you know, it's Bob, you know, and Mr. Bob, actually, some people. Anyways, just that whole relationship idea, they did it. They were at it the best. They made themselves available to us, you know, and they still say today that they had no idea what they were doing, you know.
And sure. That's the way most ministry's done, right?
Yeah. You know, and it was just, but they've changed lives. They've impacted my life with their walk with the Lord and their relationship with the Lord and what they've grabbed from the Lord and what they gave out for what they received from the Lord. They were just enormous.
Yeah.
And of course there was hard times in the ministry, you know, and I've seen that as a teenager growing up. I've seen that as a teenager with having no Jesus yet. I've seen the struggle they go through, but I've seen their faith and their trust, and they're just their you know, when you talk about money, when you talk about just the whole idea of being a missionary, you know, but they were at it the best, you know.
Yeah.
I remember the time spending with you guys in Mississippi. I know I'm like jumping, but
that's all right.
Because we are at this idea, it just reminds you just that trust that you are to have. And I saw that in you, Mike, and you and Jenna, you in Mississippi, that trust you had. You know, and I see that I saw that in my parents, that trust they had as missionaries, caring for all these kids that they weren't theirs, you know.
Right.
And they have
something to take care of your family, but to take on all of this others, that's a whole nother.
Yeah.
Story. Yeah. And seeing it now that, you know, they're still doing this. You know, knowing your parents a little bit, and I'm hopefully going to be talking to them at some point as well. You know, they've lived their entire adult lives overseas, serving communities in several countries now, and they're now in a new location over this last year. So just to see them continuing to give all that they are and all that they have in this way is you know, a testimony of their faith. And you know, safe to say that you would not be where you are or who you are had they not have visited.
Yes.
They agree. Literally, in that sense, they literally saved your life and brought you to who you are and where you are today that would have been impossible without them just taking the time.
So look at it this way. I had my first discipline ever, okay? At 14 years old. Mm. And it came from them.
Yeah, yeah. And we discipline here in America, you know, it's a bad thing, and I don't want to be disciplined. And how here you as a 14-year-old never had anyone care enough about you to show you the right way, to give you a parameter, a boundary, and you know, that act of love that says, hey, this isn't good, do this. And here for the first time at 14, you had these people pouring into you enough and caring enough to direct you and guide you. Yeah, something that we take for granted.
Yeah, and some of the responses, because I do some of the discipline today with the kids in the orphanage, but some of the responses are just like, they don't care,
yeah.
You know? But the response I had, I locked myself in the bathroom being so ashamed, being like, you know, like crying my eyes out, you know, what have I done? Mm. I have ruined the trust. Mm. You know, that bond, you know, I thought they're just going to kick me out. You know, here I am, you know, thinking beyond of what could happen, you know.
Yeah.
And, but it's true that first discipline to me, it was just like, oh my goodness, next time I need to think twice what I do, you know, because I really don't want to hurt them, mm-hmm. you know. And I was always afraid of doing that because, you know, and I've learned to deal with that rejection, you know, and that was my weakness. The weakness I had is like, I'm always afraid to to disappoint someone because they're going to reject me. Mm-hmm. They're no longer going to love me.
Sure.
You know, and things like that. And so many kids are going through that today.
Yeah.
You know, but praise God that I've gone through them, and then I can help these kids walk through it. You know,
it's not about rejection. You're uniquely qualified to minister to these kids in a way that almost nobody else could do. You know, the things you're able to relate to them on, and the knowledge that you have of their lifestyle and what it's like and what challenges they face. I mean, very few people in the world have that inside knowledge that you have. So.
My wife walked in.
Oh,
it's going on the other side. so jump into I got to visit their home in the weekends, and I did that for quite a while. Up till the final year where they continued this camp season. Mm-hmm. And this time they got to do, they were living there, and they were, my adoptive parents were in charge of these camps now. And so, they put about two or three together for the year. And then I got to go to at least two of them, and it was during that time of camp. I think it was the following year after my first initial camp that I actually got to make this decision of following Jesus. Mm. And it wasn't my dad or my mom that was talking or anything like that. I just went there as their son, as a family member and things like that. And I was part of the group of kids that were being taught, you know, Bible stories and things like that. And so, I probably told you this particular story before, because it was Steve and Alice that were missionaries, that are missionaries in the village. They were there that night sharing about the gospel and telling us about Jesus and telling us about what Jesus has done for us and telling us about just the hope and the relationship that we can have, the life eternal that God is giving us and things like that. And I remember one of the things that you would see even today is if we were to ask a group of kids in the orphanage, or actually if you were to tell them who wants, or ask them, I guess, who wants this? So like a candy or something, you see all of those hands, they will be going up, okay? Mm-hmm. So, you know, the idea of all these, you know, kids in the orphanage always receive something, you know, so they're like used to raising their hands. So Steve, at one point he asked, so after hearing this gospel and this message, who here is wanting to accept Jesus in their hearts? And so many hands, including mine, yeah, went up. Mm. But I believe that night there was only one or two of us that actually wanted this Jesus.
Sure.
You know, that we had no idea. I'm just going to talk personal. I had no idea what I was doing by raising my hands.
Right.
You know, and so many times, none of us know, you know, none of us know what we're doing or what we're getting into when you actually raise your hands, mm-hmm, you know. And so, but then what was cool about it is Steve took us that raised their hands into another room and actually explained to us step by step what have we just done, mm-hmm, you know. And he explained that, and I understood that I am surrendering my life to God and I am becoming a follower of Jesus, and my job is to build on this relationship that I get to have with Jesus Christ, and I get to read the Bible and I get to pray and I get to do all these things. And back then we were called, it's still today, is you're converting from a religion to another. And yeah, so I became one of those conversion titles,
yeah, right,
you know?
Right.
Which was really hard. It was really, really hard. Mm-hmm. And this is great when you talk about culture studies, you know, to think of switching religion, you know, yeah, how are you being still accepted, or if are you not accepted anymore? You know, are you being killed or are you being, sure, punished, or, you know, all these things. And I have been punished, I guess I could say physically. People have been like hurting me because of what I've done. People have ripped my Bible because of what I have done. People, mm-hmm, were like cussing at me because, yeah, what I have done. And it was a tough, and the hardest thing is I wasn't living with them yet.
Right, you were still in the orphanage.
I was still in the orphanage. So yeah, I would go back to the orphanage and suffer through all of this, you, mm, know? And it was really hard because the only book that I actually read or started reading, it was the Bible.
Yeah.
And then to have someone, there was no options for us to get any books. You know, nobody would ask us, would you like to read the book? You know, anything like that. So the only book I had, it was that Bible. And so it was ripped. So I was very disappointed, mm-hmm, that I didn't get to have that Bible. But it was that night that just the Lord just touched me and started working in my life and filling those gaps that I still had, even though I had that connection with my adoptive parents.
Sure.
I still had a bunch of gaps into my heart. I still had traumatized things, if you will, that I was going through. Mm-hmm. And so God was the perfect tool, I want to say, for my life, mm-hmm, you know, because he was the only one that was able to like fill those gaps and really clear. And I have tears now. Sorry.
That's all right. Those are good. Those are good tears.
Yeah. They're not fake. don't get me wrong, they're not fake. It's just when I think,
when
I think of it, it's just like, it's, he was the only one that was able to do the things that I was longing for, the things that I was really looking into my life, you know? And he has given me that purpose, and he has given me, and that night was like the hope, the overwhelming hope that I just, I wish that I've seen it physically so that I could just like, you know, be done with it, you know? But you had to have, I've learned, you had to have that faith and that, and you had to make that step of faith into what God had for you, for your life, and what God had for you when you are to leave this earth, you know? And so that just, that was another life-changing for me.
You went from an orphan system with no relationships really, because, you know, again, you're used to people visiting, dropping something off and leaving, and never having a real meaningful, loving, caring relationship with another person, to within the time span of, excuse me, of a year, year and a half, you now have a family investing in your life, giving you meaningful, deep, relational contact interaction, and now you have a God brought into your life with a deep, meaningful, lasting relationship. So you went from no relationship to deep, meaningful relationships within a short time span as a very young man. That's, I mean, that's a real powerful, heavy, and challenging thing to do.
Yeah. And also to think heavenly relationship, you know, it's just all at once, you know, it's just you know,
You've got to learn now how to be a part of these relationships that you didn't have before.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And he, the way he did it, it was just perfect timing for all those things to happen. And
your audio is coming out again here.
Each of those steps that I've gone through.
Your audio is coming out again here.
Can you hear me now?
There it is. I don't know if you have to thumb over the thing or whatever. But yeah.
What about now?
Yeah, you're good there.
Okay, perfect.
Yeah.
Anyways, so yeah, that night was a very special night. It's where I found Jesus. and it's one thing that, you know, I'm still trying to change people's mind, or that their not perception, or but the way they look at it. It's not that God, that you have found God, you as a person, is that you no, because God, or God found you somehow, because he's never lost you.
Right.
You know, God was always there, and it's me that I found the true. The true God, you know, the true meaning of life, the true light. And so it was amazing. And so from there, went back to the orphanage, and then it was also during that time that I started going to church with my dad would come, my adopted dad would come and would pick us up in a big green van. You've seen it here a couple times.
Yeah.
Mike. And that was the van that would come and pick us up for church on a Sunday morning. And a bunch of the kids would pile on in the van, or would go to church. And it was during that time that after one morning service, they pulled me aside and then asked me if I would be okay of them trying to adopt me. And that was another day that was just, it was an impact.
Sure.
It made an impact to my life because of that question. But it was also confusing because I didn't understand the question, because I thought that in my mind, in the way the connection, the relationship with that I was already part of the family, you know. And so that was one of the things that I asked him, but I am part of your family, you know. And so, but also
not legally.
but I did not give them an answer, which was also, but I wanted to do something special. I like details. Like right now we get into details.
Yeah.
And I wanted to write them a special note in how I feel, you know, and make this yes into like a detailed note, you know? And so, you know, of course I wrote the note, and this is what I've gone ever since I met you. This is how I feel. And I feel like this is a big yes, you know, to that question, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And so, but things, you know, things went on, they started the process and everything. And I, like you mentioned before, the option back then wasn't as common, especially for an older child,
right?
You know, and like I guess
14, 15 around this time.
Yeah, 14, 15. And I guess even today, you know, people don't necessarily go up to a 14 or 15 year old, you know, especially in America here. Period adoption, it's not so common anymore. Mm-hmm. Especially with the, you know, with the orphans. Mm-hmm. And so, but it was a huge process. We had a bunch of papers expired in the meantime. There was a lot of back and forth. Mm-hmm. There was no family issues, because for sure I was abandoned twice, actually. Mm-hmm. 6 months, and then when I was older, once again. And so there was no family issues. It's just the process,
right?
The paperwork and the requirements and just the whole idea of trying to adopt a child and dealing with the social system. It was a mess. Mm-hmm. And so by this time I had turned 18. And the process was not finished, but I think it was about 6-7 months down the line when they first started this process that we actually got a legal paperwork saying that they're allowed to take me out of the orphanage into the custody. So they had custody of me.
Okay.
But it wasn't an official adoption process, but they had fully custody of me. So they were able to take me to America. And
That's a big step.
And that's a big step. Yeah. You know, they were able to take me to Austria and things like that. Just the kind of trips they were doing in Europe also. But the time I'm jumping mm-hmm. quickly to just to make the story short, by the time I turned 18, we just kind of looked at each other and said, I have been yours, I think, ever since we've met, you know. there's no purpose or reason to keep on doing this dilemma or this hassle with the paperwork. So let's just leave it at it. I choose to be with you, you know, if I need to make that in writing for the government to... Because at 18, you choose where you want to go, you know? And so I chose, but then I didn't have to do that because I was there already. I was in their custody already and stuff. And so, but I officially became, not on paper, but I officially became, when I left the orphanage, I think I had just turned 14. So it was like basically a year after they moved that I was in their house.
Yeah.
And so, and then it was during that time when I came, when I moved in with them we moved in, they moved in into this house where we are now.
Just house for you a little, living now, yeah.
A little glimpse, you know.
It's the house and the ministry home, so yeah.
Yeah, my house and the ministry. And so, and what a story this house has, you know. I can go on and on about the story about this house. Yeah. So, anyways, now, but
when,
when did
you move to America?
Okay, so I turned 18, and that year we actually went to, the year I turned 18, we went to Austria. I'm just gonna give you a quick background before I moved to the States. Okay. We went to Austria for a missions conference. And it was there in Austria. It was my second time with them there. It was there in Austria. A couple came up to me and asked me if I'm interested in going into the Bible college in Hungary. Mm-hmm. And I had just finished school. I had just graduated. And I said, yes, it was a perfect move for me, especially if I'm going to build on this relationship with God and on, you know, learning the Bible and things like that. Mm-hmm. So I made a decision of, going to Bible college. Now, to go back a little bit, during my time with my parents here, my adoptive parents here, a bunch of these teams that had come in the beginning had started coming back again. Mm. And it was the home church of my adoptive parents. So they started coming every summer, every Christmas. We were doing Christmas in Romania we did that for many years. We were doing summer camps in Romania. We did that for many years. During this time, a beautiful lady started coming, called Elizabeth.
Yeah.
She was 15 at the time, and I was 17 at the time. And we got to know each other, and I thought she was the cutest thing, and I think she thought the same thing of me. I had to.
I think she had a different opinion of you, but you know.
Yeah. Just to put in a little humor in there. Although I got better at English, I used the translator to go up to Elizabeth and tell her that I think she's cute. So just. And it was during the mission. Just don't do what I did on the mission field. So if missionaries listen to this, or short mission trips, do not do what I did.
don't look for your spouse on a short-term mission.
Do not look for your spouse. But it just happened. It was first love, you know? That story in itself, you know, I can go on. But we, just a few months later, after she went back, I stayed here. I asked her if she would like to be my girlfriend through Yahoo Messenger at the time. And, we started dating and things like that. And, go back to the college. I went to Bible college, and the year I went to Bible college, that's the year that she went to Bible college, but in Marietta. And so we both started college at the same time. And then our second year, she had transferred her studies from Marietta to Hungary. So we finished our second year of college there, the college there. And it was that semester, our last semester, that we both came home for Christmas and spent Christmas here and got engaged here. I'm not going to tell you years because I'm just Bucharest telling you in words.
So when you say you went home.
In Bucharest. So we came home. Back.
Okay.
Yeah. So Lizzie, instead of going back home to America, she came over with me to Bucharest, and we spent Christmas together here with my family.
Yeah.
And it was during that time that Lizzie and I got engaged. Mm-hmm. Here on Christmas Day, 6 o'clock in the morning, had to do it before all the gifts. In this house, okay, upstairs in our living room now.
Yep, your mom and dad were talking about that story, right? Saw them last.
Yeah. And we got engaged here. And it wasn't 2.5 years later that we that we actually got married. So we got engaged here. Then we went back to Bucharest. We went back to Hungary. We finished school, graduated together. I came back to Bucharest. She went back to the States. And we had that long distance relationship, being engaged and things. And while we were doing that, we started working on paperwork for me to go to the States to have the wedding there.
Yeah.
And so because of our situation, not being officially adopted, it was still a little harder for me to go to the States. Mm-hmm. And so we started working on a K-1 visa, fiance visa, where I would get 90 days in America, and within those 90 days, we would have to get married. And so we did that, and it was a long process. So by the time I turned 22, okay, 22, maybe 21, maybe it was a year before. Mm-hmm. It wasn't until I was 21, 22 that I had come to the States. My first time in the States, because, you know, some of the stories of people adopting kids from here is they had taken the kids to America right away.
Sure.
You know? And so I think out of all the cases that I know of, I'm the only case that I actually stayed back here. And so, and God only knew, even looking at it now, God knew the reason, you know? And so, anyway, so I went to the States, and we had the wedding there. And then our whole plan was to go back to the States. Mm-hmm. I mean, for me to go to the States and have the wedding there. And then soon after the wedding that we would come back for ministry here. And so to Bucharest.
Yeah.
But that did not work out.
Right, right.
The plans that we had, it did not work out. And that's how we end up doing a little bit of ministry in California. That's how we end up meeting you, Mike, in Mississippi.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's how we end up, you know, spending a few months in Florida and then coming back to California. And during that time, I also was involved in Mexico. And so we were really busy, but it was a training. I want to call it a training. What do you call it?
Your season of equipping.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Whatever we were doing, God was training us. God was preparing us for what He has for us here. And I want to say I've learned a lot from you, Mike, in Mississippi, from you, from Chris and whoever was, you know, being able to meet Heather and Sean and all those people there, you know.
Yeah, that was a great season. Yeah.
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 And so, and then I've learned a lot in Florida. And so the circumstances were a bit different. We were pretty much on our own, but God only knew.
Yeah.
And so, going back to California and being involved for quite a few years in the church there and refuge, building up the team we have today for moving back to California and doing all this time, we've been able to even build a team, a care team as Refuge calls it, for that care for missionaries, that help missionaries with the fundraising. And so all this time, it was perfect timing for what God was going to do here in Romania. And so we've officially been missionaries since 2009. Mm-hmm. Through the different, you know, I think we became official missionaries when we moved to Mississippi. Uh-huh. And so, and we weren't fully supported by anybody. Actually, we weren't supported by anybody. We just became missionaries and we just lived by faith, you know.
Yeah, what you learned from your parents.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. Yeah. So, and it has been amazing, and to truly see how God provided every step of the way. Mm-hmm. And then as we went back to California, we kind of took my parents' steps. We did exactly what my parents did. When we went back to California, 6 months later, we were here, you know. Yeah. So, you know, how my parents the first time went back to the States after coming to Bucharest for the first time, and 6 months later, they moved back. And so just the location, you know, if you think of it, that's how my parents did it, right? You know, coming from California, 6 months later, moving back to Bucharest. Yeah. And so we did that. We were here, I want to say, you know, for about 3 months, the first time around. We're doing some kind of scouting type thing, you know, but we weren't really doing it because we came alongside a ministry that was established here already, working with the orphans and running camps and things like that. So we did that for the first 3 months. And we felt like, okay, this is where we're coming back to. Our first few years here, we did that. We came alongside a ministry called Stepping Forward Ministry. They're serving the same group of kids the same orphanage that I came out of. Uh-huh. And that just kind of what drew me to, because I kind of knew some of the staff and I knew some of the kids, although there was a whole different generation, being raised up. And so we did that for a while. And then there was a bit of a bad circumstance that we had to like leave the ministry. And back in 2016, we established our own ministry. Mm-hmm. And this ministry is called Refuge Center Romania, that we have now. And we did not change the location after leaving the first initial ministry. We did not change the group of kids. We just pretty much changed the official, I don't know how you put it. You probably put it in a better way.
Just the organization that's doing it. The name.
Just the, yeah, the yeah, organization the that's doing it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And so I just feel like I am not where I was at. I am not able to fulfill what's really on my heart. Mm-hmm. I'm not able to, you know, elaborate, you know, sure. You know, deepen my calling, you know.
Yeah.
And so with many other things, we just felt like, okay, I think our season here is finished and we'll see what God has next. Refuge Center was born during that time. And we kept at it the same kind of ideal work, ministering to the kids, but we wanted to be more intentional. We wanted to be more relationable. We wanted to be deeper we didn't want to give them all the things they want, all the things they think they deserve, but we wanted to give them a deeper meaning, a life. And it's not what I was getting to do to decide to add the ministry. And so we established this ministry, and we we're at it.
Yeah.
We basically just me and a little bit Lizzie, but Lizzie had the kids. Mm-hmm. Anyways, to go back to our marriage, we got married in 2007, and in 2008 we had our first daughter, mm-hmm. Named Anna Rose, the most beautiful creation that the Lord has made. I'm sure every dad will say that about their own kids. So
probably you're a little on that one, but she is a beautiful young woman.
now she's a young woman. She's 11 years old. Mm-hmm. And later on we had Jasmine and we had Elsa, and Jasmine now is 10 years old, mm-hmm. and Elsa is 6 years old. And we've been in Bucharest, back in Bucharest since 2012. And 2012? Yes.
8 years?
The summer of 2012, I think, or the fall, going into 2013. Mm-hmm. And we've established this ministry since 2016. And we've been ministering to the same group of kids for many, many years. Now, some of the kids are older. Some of the kids are out of the system. We're still very well connected with them, very well making sure that they're okay. We've been able to build on this amazing relationship with the majority of the kids that we're working with. And we're not just working with this boys orphanage that I came out of. We're working with four other ones. Yeah. So we have about 115 kids that we work with throughout the year. Mm-hmm. And we actually just did a number, put down a number. We work with directly at this time. We work with 85 kids on a monthly basis, I want to say, because we don't get to see them all in a week. Mm-hmm. And then with that, we're also working to minister to the staff. And yeah. We have about 74 staff that we're serving or we're working alongside. Because this is the idea, the kind of work that we're hoping for people to see, you know, even people in the orphanages, you know, we don't want to start anything new in the life of these kids, but we want to add a fire,
yeah,
into their lives. And we want to come alongside the staff. We want to come alongside the government. We want to empower them and encourage them and even give them a little training in how to deal with these kids. You know, we're not just reaching out to these kids, but we're reaching out to the staff, because we're not there 24/7. They're there.
Right.
They're there 24/7.
You're affecting their life by trying to change all of the different factors in their life. I mean, it's one thing to go and give something to an orphan and bless them in that way, but it's another thing to impact the different things that affect their life as well. Because this is their entire life in that orphanage there.
So yeah.
If you're able to minister to the ladies that work in the homes, and then you're able to minister to them and allow them to pass that ministry on to the kids, you're affecting their life in an indirect way, but something that is going to change the lives of the kids throughout their daily lifestyle, even when you're not there.
Exactly. Exactly. Yeah.
Tell me the difference right now between the orphan system when you grew up in it and how it is today. What are some of the changes that you've seen there?
Yeah, there are definitely a lot of changes. Okay. So by the time I came to this particular orphanage, I transitioned out to this orphanage. The first orphanage, we would get no visitors whatsoever. So we would get to the point where we're locked down. Okay. Like, you're not able to do anything, almost to the point where you are in your room all day long doing nothing, you know? And it's the idea of being rejected. Nobody wants you. Mm-hmm. You know, nobody cares for you. Nobody, you're not going to leave this place you're never going to leave this place again, you know?
No hope.
And so, right. And so, and that's how, in my generation, it wasn't as bad as the generations before, even during the communists. I mean, you probably heard stories about kids being tied to their beds, or kids being beat up, so about kids being abused, or, you know, just like the idea of being at a concentration camp, you know, and it's just that horrible things happen to a child just because they were orphans or they're abandoned, and they're on the idea of they are unlovable, you know, people looking down at them, you know, and that was the same thing with the street kids. This city, Bucharest, was filled with street kids, you know, and people were like trashing them, you know, and it was really bad. And the difference now is still not as extreme, but you still have that lack of affection. Yeah. You get no affection whatsoever. You get no proper care whatsoever. If a parent drops you off and leaves you at the hospital, it's still, that was happening before, it still happens today. And so the moment you're there, you're on your own. So you're still getting through the system, and the system is still bad, you know.
You're pushed to the side and kind of out of the view of society, so that, you know, society doesn't have to look at that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so you don't know, back then, you don't know any better. You don't know any other things, you know, so you just go with the flow. You know, you get beat up. Mm-hmm. You know, you get abused, you know, and then you come to see that as it's part of life, I guess, you know. But now the difference now is, which is, it breaks my heart, because a good number of kids uses this, the things that are happening now, is now all the kids, I guess from the 8-9 years old, they know their rights, okay? Uh-huh. They know what their rights are. Mm-hmm. And so now the difference is they're no longer gonna let themselves abused or beat up or whatever, because they cannot be touched no more. They cannot be even yelled at no more. And so the difference is, good number of kids using this to behave bad,
right,
to become addict to the different things in the world, to become cussing all these domnas out, or, you know, all these things. And the discipline, I mean, the life before was so much better, because yes, you get beat up, but then, you know, you had yourself, you had a brother that you could, like, you know. Now they beat each other up.
Every man for himself.
Yeah, they don't have each other's back. They don't make their life, you know, together. And they're using the rights they have to get back to the system, you know.
Right. So you're able to justify a lifestyle and the activities that they're doing. They're able to kind of justify it by, you're not able to do this, so I can do whatever I want to do now, and there's nothing you can do to stop me.
And exactly,
it breeds a lack of trust amongst each other as well. So the kids' relationships are built on this mistrust and mistreatment of each other as well. So
so when people come and hear about these orphans and want to hear, you know, I have to be honest, because he's not so sad, you know. Yes, he has no family, but he's very bad, you know. Just like, sure, you know. So they're, for all I know, they don't care. And this is the kind of things that we're dealing with right now. I love these kids so much that I am willing to discipline them and to try to make a difference. And also the other thing we're running into is these kids are not wanting to show the real identity outside their orphanage.
Sure.
And so, and that's what's different, because different in this generation is because there's so many things out there. There's so many people that they can hang out with. There's so many clothes out there they can wear and become like the other ones, that they're willing to lie about who they are, right, you know, to be accepted,
sure,
by a kid of his age, you know?
Yeah.
And so now they get to the point of going out whenever they want to, whereas before, I never used to go out. I was scared to go out, you know?
Yeah.
And so, but now they're like out and about. Now they're making the life of themselves. So they're running into tons of problems.
Yeah.
You know?
And they're not in one communal house anymore. It's not 200 kids living under the same roof. There's apartments around town with 8-10 kids in an apartment.
Yeah, so that's the other thing. The other thing that's different is they stop this idea of institutions to bring these kids, transition these kids into more of a family environment, homes, you know, so-called in the States foster homes, you know. And so, but a foster home is, I guess, when a kid goes to a regular family, right?
Right.
And that kid gets to have a life there. And then, but this still run by the government. So the government still hires people, still hires, you know, night shift to take care of these kids, but there's smaller numbers of kids. And there's about 11 apartments that we're trying to connect with, on a daily basis. And there's still two institutions that we're still working with.
Right.
And so, yeah, it's, I think it's a lot more work this time around than it's ever been in the past. Than it's ever been with us, with me, the only work they had to do with me is to help me get through this traumatized, you know, an emotional status, or, you know, and then putting me into a home, you know. Whereas these kids, they have no, I mean, majority of them have nobody, but these kids, I think they're trying to fill their lives with everything else in the world,
sure,
in the world. And back then we didn't have many options, you know? And so it's definitely a different life for them, a different generation. They actually have more chances in this life around than the, you know, than my generation, but there's some kids that they just don't take it, you know, you know, and so this is where God has us to work through these things with the kids. We just had a conversation with a couple of the kids, a counseling session with a couple of the kids, and the idea of being accepted by the outside world. How do you do that? Right. Well, first, you have to accept who you are. Nothing's going to change, you know. This is who you are. And if you accept who you are, it's going to be so much easier, sure, to go into the world, you know.
And these kids don't have an identity for themselves. They're this piece in a system, but they have no personal identity of who they are or what their character is like, or, you know, they have no individual understanding of themselves. So then to go out into a community, you're just trying to be a part of this system now in a bigger, bigger scale.
Yeah. Or they get to the point where they blame themselves. This is my fault because I'm in this situation.
Right.
You know, this is what I've done. That's why my parents threw me in the orphanage, because of what I've done.
Yeah.
You know, But then some kids are thinking, what have I done? I can't think of anything bad that I've done to my parents that I deserve this, you know? Sure. So they just like a bunch of things back and forth. And, you know, they don't know how to categorize those things in their head, you know? And it just makes things harder when it comes to misbehavior, when it comes to responses, when it comes to responsibilities, because you have a 16-year-old now, or 17-year-old now, that is dealing with that kind of stuff, mm-hmm. you know? And at 17, you have responsibilities, you know? You got school, you got studies, you got things that you have to work on. Mm-hmm. You can't just be on your device anymore. So you're working things out, but yeah. they have no way to think through that big because they have nobody to help them through.
Sure.
And that's
sure.
how... That's where we come in. We're helping these kids, these older kids, to really think about these things, and we're making life with them. I want to put myself in their shoes because I have been in their shoes, and yeah. I want to help them. I want to help them through them, you know, yeah. through it all, you know. Of mm-hmm. course, I'm not going to force things upon them, but most kids that we're working with, they want this help. Yeah. They don't know how to ask.
Yeah.
But they want this help, you know, and so we're just privileged, and we're so blessed to be part of this work with the orphans, you know. And yeah, I don't, going back to what you just said earlier, I don't know what would have happened with my life if it wasn't for my adoptive parents, you know.
Absolutely. Yeah.
And so, and then looking at these kids, if they don't stretch their arms out to take as much from us, you know, and from, and us giving them God, they would end up bad. Because we had a situation a few years ago where we had a kid from the same orphanage that I grew up in die of overdose, you know,
yeah.
because... You know, and I want to say these kids have such a high potential mm-hmm. into making it.
Absolutely.
You know, mm-hmm. and now is the time, even during this time of crisis, now is the time to give them Jesus. Now is the most sensitive time that kids or even people, adults, will grab onto Jesus, yeah. you know. Because it's what they're looking for. They yeah. just don't know it. But that's what people look for when they look somewhere else. They look for someone, for something that's going to fill their lives and, you know, and to make them feel like they're worth something, you know?
Yeah. And in these childhood years, these are such formative years for a kid. They're forming yeah. their identity. They're forming their understanding of relationships. They're forming their understanding of how to operate in the world and what's good and what's not. That's laying the foundation for who they become as adults. And if you have these kids in the orphanage with no discipline, no structure, all of these sorts of things, they're laying a poor foundation that's going to last.
It's going
to be very difficult to overcome that as they get older.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, sure. So having a ministry like this, I mean, you're pouring into the kids at the most fruitful time of their life. That's going to affect them in incredible ways. And I'll say this about you, Costi. You and I have had a chance to minister in many places together. We've traveled to India together and been able to serve there and stuff. And you are a Pied Piper for kids, is what I tell people. You just walk into an area and you're like a magnet. Kids come out of the woodwork and just focus around you. We could be in a group of 10 people, and within 5 minutes of arriving in a place, you have a crowd of kids around you. I think in India, we call them your army, because every village we went into, every place we went, you had Costi's army, you know, that would follow you around like a Pied Piper. And you would sit there in the dirt. I remember just pull out your phone and just flip through pictures with these kids, play a game with the kids. You would take their pictures. You exchanged Facebook, you know, info. And, you know, these probably the first time for most of these kids that anyone has given them that much attention, even for the few minutes that you were there. So to know that you're able to go into these orphanages and sit not just for a one-time 5 minute, 10 minute, hour long or a day long, but an ongoing year after year, month after month, day after day basis to pour into these kids, you know, it's something that no one else is doing. It's something that just isn't present there in that system that will have lasting fruitful effects in all of their lives. And I've seen several of these kids that are now 17, 18, 19 years old, you know, some of these guys that are now my size and standing a head taller than you and to see that.
Oh yeah.
These big boys, I mean, these are intimidating boys, but the respect that they have for you because of the place that you've had in their life, it speaks a lot to the ministry that's there. And what these guys are really genuinely looking for is just that acceptance and that relationship. And so,
yeah,
so it's a great thing. Well, let's finish with this. What are some of your future plans? What are you looking forward to in the coming months and years there in the ministry?
Yeah, I just had a lunch meeting with a friend of mine yesterday, and we were talking about just the different goals and different values and things like that. And I kind of share with him my dreams that I have for the ministry. But then along with that, we are continuing our conversation, but something just came into my mind as we were talking, and this is what I like to see us move forward, and just the kind of future plans that we have for the ministry is this idea. We continue with this idea of building this relationship with these kids and continue our day-to-day things to them, loving on them and crying with them if we had to. And just being that arm for them and that comfort that they're looking for. And but then along with that, we're just looking at just the bigger picture, okay, of how do we best train these people, the staff and the government into, yes, we're coming alongside, but we're like such a small compared to what they could do if we were to train them right. And also if we were to have a few of these people become believers, what a transformation, what a better chance of really making a difference in these kids' lives, you know? And so as we continue this thing, I had this idea of what if we implant or get a couple Christians to get a social worker job in the government, people that we would talk to them initially and encourage them. And it's not just about the money. As a believer, it's not, when you have a job, it's not about the money, but it's about you being yourself and making a difference and taking Jesus even farther, even at your workplace. You know, what if we talk to some of these young people that are Christians and things like that and get them to work for the government and putting them into that position of ministering to these people that are working to make life better for the kids, you know, but bringing some kind of training sessions into training these people into making this work even better at it, you know, and also working with the staff at the orphanage with the 74 people working alongside them, taking them out for coffee, for an ice cream, right, away from the kids and really ministering to them. Because the other day we were at this apartment and one of our teammates asked this lady, what if I take you for a coffee one time? Now, like you said earlier, nobody else is doing this for these kids. Well, nobody else has asked any staff if they could be taken out for a coffee To them, it's like it blows. You mean you'll watch over the kids and I go after a coffee with you?
It's almost a thankless job that they're doing.
So yeah.
Not only are the kids put away and forgotten, the people taking care of the kids are forgotten and almost the outskirts of
society. But these people are doing it for the money, okay? Mm-hmm. And we want to bring that, turn that around. Mm-hmm. Okay, you are getting money out of it, mm-hmm. but we need your heart into it. These kids will only work with you if you're genuine and sincere in your relationship with them. Yeah. For them to come to respect you, they have to see love out of you. And how do you do that? And we want to come alongside you and help you. And we want you to put your heart into what you're doing and not necessarily converting them to God. That is his job, okay? My job is to be that Christian, that example, and doing what the gospel, what the Bible says, and being that Christian and loving them, mm-hmm. and sharing with them about the life of Christ. But if I were to do something now, I would train them, and I would ask them, okay, what is your heart telling? Are you wanting to be here?
right.
Because this is your problem. This is why you're not getting into these kids' lives, because of you. Yeah. You know, and I want, and through this, they're going to see it and they're going to, okay, how do I do that? Mm-hmm. You know, and that's when you see the sincere heart of mm-hmm. wanting to do their job. And that's the biggest problem in the whole system. Mm-hmm. In the whole system, even in America, when you think of it, these people don't put their heart at what they do.
It's a paycheck, you know, not
a paycheck, not. And when you work with the kids, it's not the paycheck, okay? Yeah. It's not about the paycheck. It's about the child, mm-hmm. you know? It's as if you're looking at your own child, okay? Mm-hmm. What would happen if your child was in that situation? You're going to give them the attention that they need. And so act like this is your child. So our goal is to really come up with ways to minister to these people, to the staff, mm-hmm. and to really come alongside the government, because I cannot change the system on my own. Yeah. I wish I can,
right.
But what I could do is coming alongside them, having regular meetings with these people, mm-hmm. and really share our hearts out, really share the idea of the child, okay? This child will lose his life if we don't do something about it, okay? Mm-hmm. And then let's treat this kid like it was your kid, you know? And so how do you do that? Well, let's work together. And so we want to come up with, that's my goal for the year. Okay. The dreams was like two apartments, one van, and more people to work with. Okay. I'm still needing the people, mm-hmm. but my dreams change. I want to work with the people in the field, and I want to make this work so that we could better do our job, you know?
Sure. Instead of bringing all these outside people in and trying to insert them in the system, you've already got people in the system that you can work with to train them up and equip them to do their job.
Yeah, because they're I'll tell you this, they're never going to leave, because they actually get paid really well. Mm-hmm. Okay. Mm-hmm. How do we work that for our benefit, for our purpose being in there? In this working with them,
sure.
You work with them directly, mm-hmm. you know, because they're always going to be the 24/7 people there, and so mm-hmm. we need to love them. Yeah. We need to mm-hmm. ask them how they're doing. We need to train them. We need to help them to put their heart at work. Yeah. You know.
And well, that's good stuff.
So anyways, that's my goal.
Awesome. That's awesome. So Well, as we wrap up here, what is it that you would say to that person living in the States or living somewhere else? How is it that they can be interested, that they can get behind what's going on, that they can stay on top of what's going on? What would you say to that person that's hearing this and saying, you know what, that sounds awesome. What do I do?
Yeah, I mean, we're probably never going to run away from receiving teams. Mm-hmm. I think a key to having people and loving on our kids, it goes a long way, because I was one of those kids that was loved by a team. Mm-hmm. And so this will never run away from, we will never change that. So we would definitely ask people to pray as they hear this, if they would like to come on a short-term team, to pray and get hold of us and ask how do I best do that, and when's the best time to come. And we definitely could get are more than welcome for people to come. Mm-hmm. We're always looking for people to help our ministry. You know, ministries are always have expenses, as you know, Mike. And so can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. So we always look for people to help our ministry. And so
I know you talked about bringing a social bringing a social worker on staff with the ministry to help, and having those consistent people, because we talked about the consistency of relationships. So you have to have people that are dedicated to this ministry, which means they're not able to go and pursue their finances elsewhere. So yeah, support is always
we're definitely looking for volunteers, but also for full-time workers, which means that we pay them, so they get to do life with us on a more permanent, you know, permanent ways. And we're always looking for people, and we're always looking for locals, for people that know the language, for people, and also for people that have the heart, and so for the specific work. And so to be able to find those people, we would have to offer them, we would have to pay them. And so we're always looking for people to help us through all of that when it comes to finances. Mm-hmm. And so we do have a flyer out, so we're willing to send that flyer out to whoever's interested, and you get more information on that. And the most important thing that we would love for people, for our ministry, is to pray. Mm-hmm. Because it's a key to, if we don't pray, things don't get done. Because we think we could do it on our strength, where we're lying to ourselves. We cannot. Mm-hmm. And I say that because I've gone through it. I've only, you know, there's been times where I've tried things on my own or through my own strength, but it's never happened.
Yep.
I'm always like frustrated. It's not happening.
Yeah. And yeah. So it doesn't work out well.
Yeah. 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 And our biggest, I think our calling as a Christian, you know, as a person in Christ, this is a key to even our walk, is to pray. And so we would love for people.
The first thing that we should do is we should always be praying about it and seeing if the Lord's knit us there. And then if we simply pray for a ministry, there's no way we're going to do the ministry.
Yeah. So we'd love for people to pray for the ministry and pray for us here, the workers. Because it's the best work that you could ever be in, but it's also the hardest work, because it's heartbreaking when you look at the different situation we're in. And the other work that we do, we work with orphanages. That's another story. That's another, I want to say another, what's the word that I'm looking? Another personality of work. Now you're working with kids that are in families, and you're working with these families, trying to keep the families together, prevent the kids from ending up into the system. And so that's the other thing that we do. So that's at a later time. But pray for more workers, and pray for us here, because it is a hard job. And it's hard to work with, even with staff that don't want to be worked on. Yeah. And it's hard to work with kids that don't want to be talked to, don't want to be disciplined, don't want to be hugged, don't want to be, you know, and things like that. And so, and then pray for the field, for the kids in the field, and for the staff, and for Romania as a whole, because it's not just Bucharest that's dealing with this, with the system, it's everywhere.
Yeah.
And so overall, pray for the orphans. And so, yeah, if God called you to Romania, please get hold of us. If God puts it on your heart to help us, get hold of us and do pray. So,
well, with that said, how does someone get a hold of you? Is there a website they can go to, email? What's the best way to get more information or even contact you directly?
Yeah, so the best way is KeenanRefugeMinistries@gmail.com. That's our ministry email. So once again, KeenanRefugeMinistries@gmail.com. That's the best way.
I'll have a link for that on our website at the Mathetai.org site. So if you want to go there, you can hear this interview there. And then we'll put all of these links to you guys on the site there as well, so people can have it there.
And we do send out a monthly newsletter. We just sent out actually our first June in a while newsletter. Mm-hmm. So, you know, just shoot us an email and we could add you on our mailing list. And we can send that out on a monthly basis. And then we're on Facebook, Refuge Center Romania. We do weekly updates. We're on Instagram, Refuge Center Romania, once again. So I do weekly updates on that. On Refuge Center, we take turns, but on Instagram, I do it myself because I have my phone. I have my phone everywhere. And so we're also Keenan. The difference between, there's no difference between Keenan Refuge Ministries and Refuge Center Romania. It's AKA, also known. We have established a ministry in America also. So if people are wanting to donate, they could get tax deductible statement back. And so, and we could get all that info to you if you're wanting to donate or get more information. So Refuge Center Romania, Facebook group, Instagram, Refuge Center Romania also. Email KeenanRefugeMinistries.com. And also, you could message me directly on Costi Keenan on Facebook. I'm also available there. And so, or you could ask Mike, my friend, my brother, Mike Plunder.
Yes, that's the message.
For all my information.
We're happy to connect anybody. We'll put every link that we can find and every link that we can make for emails and websites and giving and all that stuff on our website as well, so people can certainly get in touch with you and connect with you. So, hopefully the next time we speak, it will be face to face.
Oh, I would love that.
Yes. And perhaps if we are able to, we can bring some other folks along with us and get to introduce them to the orphanages and the ministry there and what's going on. So, well, thank you for your time today, for giving up what is your evening there in Romania. And thank your family for us as well. And we look forward to the updates coming soon, and we'll definitely see, some of these young men growing up and where God plants them. That's the most exciting thing on my end. I love seeing these guys as they're coming out of the system and the fruit that you've invested early on, what God does with it down the line. So
actually, to just really quick, we have one guy named Gabi that just left the orphanage, transitioned out, and he's living in our we have another house that we're continuing our rent, our old house, mm-hmm. that we used to live before we came back to this ministry house. He's living now in a transitional process from the orphanage. And so, and then we've been ministering to this kid. He's mm-hmm. now 21 years old, and he's at a verge of making that, he's on a good track. Let me put it that way, you know? And so, and this will be a, you know, that word, that term, you know, if one kid comes to the Lord,
yeah,
even the angels in the heavens will rejoice. Okay. One kid out of hundreds. Okay. Even the angels will rejoice. So, yes.
I know he's not the only one. I know there's other young men closer to his age as well, all the way down to the younger kids. So there's not just one kid through this being affected. There's hundreds. So
right. Yeah.
So. All right. Well, thank you so much for being with us, Costi. We look forward to talking to you again soon.
Thanks, Mike.
All right.
God bless you guys.
God bless you. Take care.